Now let us come to categories. In what way do you feel intense? Now I will go by the yoga terminology because it is easy. In yoga, everything is categorized into trigunas. So I will go by that. You can classify in your own way also, but trigunas are simpler classification. It's a simpler classification. You can do Daivasura also. So what is the meaning of feeling intense through tamasic way? You can feel intense tamasically also. I'm talking with respect to emotions specifically. When I say tamas, you can apply it to everything, but now I'm trying to apply it only to emotions, that intensity of thought. When you watch a horror thriller, do you feel intense? That's why you are watching. You are getting something out of it. It is making you shrink. You are shrinking in the seat. Something you are feeling as if something is compressing you. Something is some bigger force or something horrifying is coming and pouncing on you. You are shrinking, and that shrinking makes you come alive. That shrinking makes you feel intense. Fear makes you feel intense. It does make you feel intense. You feel like it is ironical, actually. Tamasic way of feeling intense is ironical. You feel lifeless and you feel intense, meaning you become energyless. Your hands and legs, they don't get fear, means you are devoid of energy, but because of that you feel intense. Because energy is taken away from you, you feel energetic at some other level. See, otherwise, if you don't look at it that way, can you explain to me why do people watch horror movies? Tell me, if they are not feeling intense, why are people watching horror? Some of you may be watching already. Why do you think you watch horror movies? If it is giving you only, if you say it is bad, 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 yes, it is bad, but it is giving you intensity. It is making you feel intense. It is making you something it is giving you. And therefore, you watch. And it is tamasic way. Yes, it is giving you something, but it is tamasic way. Now, if you take it a level below, if you have a few more examples from real life. Some people like to feel intense by thinking that everybody is victimizing them. It's a disorder in psychology. Psychology in psychology, they speak of it. Some people like to think that everybody is victimizing them. They always want to be like that. Somebody or the other, even if nobody is doing anything, they will make up some story that somebody is victimizing me. They will be simply walking, wandering, and somebody sitting on that bench laughed. They will think that they are laughing on me. You want some reason to feel intense. And getting victimized is a way for you to feel intense. Everybody is always poking me. Even if they are not, you start imagining. It will become a disorder eventually. And people say, I don't know if it is true or not. In psychology they say, and also in Adhyatma also, they speak of it. People who have that kind of psychology, who want to always feel that they are victimized. Non-verbally, they will communicate that to others, and it will so happen that others will victimize them. They are actually waiting to be victimized. They want to get victimized. They may complain about it. It will look as if they don't want it, but the actual fact is that they have gotten addicted to it. You have become addicted to somebody victimizing you. To some extent, everybody will do that. You like to talk if somebody victimizes. Victimizing is somebody has talked ill of you. If somebody has talked ill of you, and if you get to hear that, you will speak on it 100 times. Some will speak on it for 100 times, some will speak for 10 times, some may speak just once. Why is somebody speaking about it 100 times? Because they are liking it. They like to feel that they are victimized. Do you know what he spoke of me? You will tell that story 100 times. Are you following what I am saying? Some may say it just once, some may not even say it. They may not find intensity in that. They might have found a better way to feel intense, and therefore they will give up these means. When somebody talks ill of them, they will not consider it something to be spoken of. They will ignore it because they have found a better way to feel intense. I will come to that. So when you have not found a better way to feel intense in your life, you will give way to these means. Somebody spoke ill of me, it will become a huge thing for you, and you will speak of it for a whole day. It is tamasic way of feeling intense. It is feeling intense, but tamasic way. If you take it one level even below, if you go into proper psychiatric disorder, some people will feel intense by inflicting pain upon themselves. Meaning they don't know of any better way to feel intense. Pain becomes the way to feel intense. Pain becomes a way to feel alive. So if somebody is hitting them, they will inflict pain on themselves. Cutting themselves gives them some liveliness, I don't know what. It gives them something, some intensity. If you take it even further below, to its extreme, nothing else, they are not able to feel intense through life at all, they will try to feel intense through death. They will try to commit suicide and feel intense for that few moments because they don't know how to feel intense. Through any other way, they will feel intense. They will try to feel alive by dying. Irony, it is so. Now this is all the lower extreme, and this is called to be tamas because it is not a sustainable way to feel intense. So if you look at it from the primary goal of all human beings is to finally live life to the fullest extent. Everybody is trying to live life to the fullest extent. Is there any doubt in that? There is no doubt in that. But the way in which you are achieving may be of various types. And if you are wise, you have to find ways which are sustainable, which are kind of win-win for yourself and the world. If you go by tamasic way, it is a lose-lose situation. It is not sustainable, first of all. If you go on watching horror movies, you will become a psychopath. There is no other end to that. And you will become a problem for the world also. After watching too many ghosts, you will become a ghost for the world. It will affect your psychology in some way or the other. It will. You cannot help it. So it is a lose-lose situation. You are corrupting your physiology. You are corrupting your psychology. You are corrupting your entire chemistry. If you take a corresponding example in the physical level, taking drugs and feeling happy is a tamasic way of feeling happiness. You are shaking up your entire physiology, you are torturing your physiology and feeling happy, feeling intense. I mean, don't bring the word happy there. What I mean by happy is you feel intense. You get intense experience by torturing your physiology or torturing your psychology. It is not a sustainable way. So today people give out this argument. People who don't have the clarity of thought, they will stop at the first initial stage of analysis. They will say, the purpose of life is to feel as much intense as possible. The purpose of life is to live life to the fullest extent as much as possible. Therefore, I will get it in whatever way possible. Teenagers, if there are teenagers in your house, they will give this argument. They are intelligent, but they are dumb also at the same time. They are not able to go beyond one level. That analysis is correct. The analysis is correct. Yes, that everybody wants to increase the intensity of life as much as possible. Even a yogi is trying to do the same thing. He is not trying to become dull or anything. Everybody is trying to do the same thing. But if you are a little more intelligent, you will find sustainable ways. You will not go to unsustainable ways. You will find some ways which will work out in the long run. It should not run out in a few years. The way which you adopt should not exhaust itself in few years. After 5 years, if it has exhausted your physiology and psychology, and if you have become a psychopath or something, if you lose the ability to live properly, then it is not a good way to feel intense. Although it is making you achieve the goal of feeling intense, it is not a good way to feel intense. The goodness is decided by the sustainability. So tamasic way we do it. I told that because I gave you extreme examples, but to some extent everybody will do it. There is some extent of tamas in everybody. You cannot deny that. That therefore I gave an example which is relatable to us. If you hear that somebody has spoken ill of you, that news that somebody spoke ill of me at some very core level gives you some kind of sadistic pleasure. And you therefore you go on speaking about it with everyone you see. Otherwise, why will you speak of it? Tell me. If you are not finding happiness out of an activity, you don't do it. You will not do it. So there will be some amount of tamas in us. You cannot help it. I gave extreme examples also. But you have to identify that there is some quotient of tamas in us, and we are yielding to tamasic emotions sometime or the other. And that is tamas. Slightly better way of feeling intense is rajasic way, and that is I don't have to explain it much because we are all masters of it already. Rajasic way is the most sought after way of feeling intense. All the movies, all the news channels, what they give you is rajas, sometimes tamas also. Actually news channels give you tamas, actually. I'm sorry. Now rajasic way of feeling intense, all of you are very, you know, very much. Best example is that of anger. Or today, if you ask me, the best example is that very general word which you are using, stress. People say stress is bad, I don't want stress, but actually speaking, everybody is addicted to stress. That is why people started stress management, because they want to keep it and then manage it. They don't want to get rid of it. Stress has to be there only. Without stress, what life? People sometimes argue also. Actually, people argue even for fear. They will say that only if you have fear, only if you have that instinct, you will act more. They don't know of a better way of action, and therefore they are justifying fear. They say you should have fear, and only if you have fear it will make you do more. Have you heard these arguments? Modern psychology and all, they argue. They say in the same way they will justify anger also. Since they don't know of a better way to act, they always yield to tamas rajas. Since they don't see sattva at all, they always yield to tamas rajas. Because everybody is having fever in the world, you think that fever is the way. You don't even try to see that there is a better way. So a rajasic way of feeling intense is very much known. Or what is being sold through movies in the name of entertainment is rajas. That makes you feel intense. Some hero and villain fighting makes you feel intense. Some hero and heroine making some stupid romantic dialogues makes you feel intense, and makes you think that that is the ultimate. If you come to spirituality, actually speaking, all these things should look funny to you. Romance that happens in the movie should look funny to you. Actually, it should look childish to you. The entertainment of the movie should look childish to you. It is not that you will hate it. It will look funny to you. You will laugh at that. If you find sattvic way, you will laugh at rajas and sattvic tamasic way of feeling intense. It will look petty to you. It will look childish to you. So rajasic way you anyway know. And that also people get addicted to it. People do feel addicted to rajasic way of feeling intense and emotional. But these two, tamasic and rajasic emotions, if you take a decision, if you try to take a decision in your life, when you are emotional in the tamasic or rajasic way, it will not be a wise decision. So don't try to categorize, don't try to say that all emotions are bad. Tamasic and rajasic emotions they are not good in the sense you will make very dumb decisions. because it will cloud your intelligence also. Whatever little intelligence is there, that also gets clouded. So you have, when you say, people usually make you give out the statement, they will say, head and heart, and they always try to glorify the heart. That is okay, I agree with that, but don't try to put all the emotions into heart. Don't put tamasic and rajasic emotions into heart. Don't put this this ordinary romantic emotions which happens because of sexual attraction into heart. It is not in the heart, it is in the head again. It is again in the hormones. It is not coming from the heart. So if you take a romantic decisions, it will be dumb. You know it very well, better than me. If you take a decisions out of being in a romantic mode, afterwards you will repent. You must have already. In Ramayana, there is a very big example. Dasharatha, in that romantic mood, said to Kaikeyi, you ask anything you want, I give you. And then happened, the whole Ramayana happened because of that. You know that? Kaikeyi asked for, she said, I will ask when time is ripe. She is intelligent, she was not romantic. Dasharatha was idiotically romantic and therefore he suffered. So don't put all the emotions in heart and don't say heart is better than head, no. There are some emotions which are below the head also, which are worse than the head, which are worse than intelligence also. Okay, so don't try to glorify heart always. Decipher it properly. Don't put tamas and rajas also into heart. So, intelligence is better than tamasic and rajasic intensity. Intelligence. I'm not glorifying intelligence. I'm saying intelligence is better than tamasic and rajasic way of feeling intense. And if you look at it in English, if you go to the root of the word emotion, it has some Latin or Greek root, I don't know what. Emotion, in its Latin root, it means disturbance. It means disturbance. The meaning of the root word from which this word emotion has come, it means disturbance. So, you have to put only the tamasic and rajasic emotions under that. They are emotions, but they are disturbing type of emotions. They make you unstable. They don't make you stable. They make you more and more agitated and unstable. And if you take a decision out of that instability, they will not be correct decisions. So, remember that emotions, when you speak of it in this way, are disturbances. See, it is evident in English also. When a letter is delivered to you physically, you call it as mail. When a letter is delivered to you in electronic format, you call it as email, soft copy. So when something moves physically, it is called motion. When something moves in your software, it is called emotion. Incidentally, it matches. I mean, they did not have this in their head, but it somehow matches. When your software moves, it is emotion, and that is intensity. Movement is kinetic energy, it is intensity, and that is the idea you will see in Bhagavad Gita also. How did they define stress? Speed. Where did they take that speed idea from? No. It's from Bhagavad Gita. Kama Krodhos Bhavam Vegam. Who withstands the Vega of Kama? He gives Kama Krodha as a sample there. But what he means is Rajas in general. So Vega is generated. Vega means speed. Speed means movement. So when that extreme speed is generated, extreme movement is generated, it is emotion. And when it is disturbing you, when it is of a disturbing type, it is rajasic or tamasic. But there, now I said that intelligence is better than these two. Intelligence is better than disturbing type of emotions, destabilizing emotions. But above the intelligence, there is another type of emotion which makes you feel more stable, which gives you stability, which gives you a feeling of fulfillment. Rajasic and tamasic type of emotions, if you have to analyze it in a slightly another way, they make you feel empty. They give you a sense of emptiness, and to fulfill them you will do something. See, when you feel angry, are you feeling fulfilled or empty? You feel some void there, and to fill that void you get angry and you do something, and because of that something, your anger is it gets subdued, and then you feel fulfilled. Something happens outside and only then you feel fulfilled. So the root of that emotion is emptiness, because you feel some kind of void inside, some kind of vacuum inside. To fulfill that, you are giving out some movement, giving out some intensity, and try to do something outside. So world has to have, something has to happen outside you, and if it happens in a particular way, you will feel fulfilled. So these emotions, rajas and tamasic emotions, are seeking emotions. They are emotions that are arising out of a feeling of emptiness, not fulfillment. Are you following me? Everybody? So this tamasic and rajasic type of emotions arise so that you will do something, so that something will happen around you, and that will give you fulfillment. Meaning, your sense of emptiness and your sense of fulfillment, both are dependent on the world. If something is not happening in a particular way, it arises anger in you, it arises irritation in you, it arises stress in you, whatever it arises, something. Or it arises fear in you. Something did not go in a way that you wanted it to go. It arises a tamasic or a rajasic emotion. So something did not happen in the way I wanted. So you feel empty until it happens the way you want. So that emptiness gives out some emotion, and that is tamas or rajas. You may either run away from it, you may either try to cut yourself off from it and feel fulfilled. You try to insulate yourself from that, don't even see that. That is tamasic way, meaning you don't even try to perceive it. Something is going wrong terribly. If you see that, you will feel empty, and therefore you won't even see that. Ignore it. Negligence. Tamasic way of feeling fulfilled. It is not fulfilled, it's inertness. So in this tamasic and rajasic way of feeling empty and fulfilled, you are completely dependent on the world. The world makes you feel empty, the world makes you feel fulfilled, again the world makes you feel empty, again the world makes you feel fulfilled. Your switch is in the hands of the world. Your switch is in the hands of your husband. Your switch is in the hands of your wife. Everybody's switch is in somebody else's hands. If you have kids, it might have come to your experience. Kids know exactly what is to be done to make you angry. And they do that. Deliberately they do that. Because they enjoy seeing you angry. I remember my childhood, I used to do that myself. So it is almost like the switch of your anger is with your child now. And they like, just like how you enjoy playing a video game, if I press this, something happens in the TV. Similarly, they'll press something, father got angry. Something like that only. They're trying to play a video game. Because your emptiness and fulfillment are both dependent on what the child will do, or what the husband will do, or what the wife will do. Your fundamental sense of fulfillment, I'm talking about. So this is another way of looking at tamas and rajas. The emotions are arising out of emptiness, not fulfillment. Whereas if you compare it with sattvic emotion, sattvic emotions come out of fulfillment, and they are not seeking anything in return, because you are already fulfilled. The expression of fulfillment happens as an activity, and those activities are not seeking something again from it, so it automatically becomes karma yoga also. So when you feel emotional, when you feel intense in sattvic way, it does not make you feel empty, it makes you feel fulfilled, and that fulfillment overflows as activity. Now for this, usually people give the example of mother-child, but I am kind of bored of that. People give usually mother-child relationship. They give, I won't give that again. Meaning when you have love for your child, it is an overflowing of an emotion. It is not seeking something in return. It may seek still, there may be 10% seeking, but 90% is simply an expression. So I won't again give mother-child. You all know that example very well. Throughout this Bhakti Sutra class, I will give another example which is very close to actual bhakti. Patriotism. When you feel patriotic, when you look at your national flag, do you feel empty or fulfilled? You feel stable or unstable?
Stable.
It stabilizes you, but at the same time you will get tears also. If you are a real patriot, if you are thinking of the grandeur of your country and all the things are hitting you from deep within, you feel full. You don't feel empty. And because you feel full, you will do something. If you are real patriotic, either you will simply shout Bharat Mata Ki Jai and not do anything else, or you will really try to do something. So here the activity is not a seeking activity, it is an activity that is arising out of fulfillment. But that too is not completely out of fulfillment. See, patriotism still is not yet bhakti, it is very close to bhakti. In patriotism again there is some sense of emptiness. You want something to happen, there is something still, it is not completely a fulfillment and you do something, it is not that yet. If it is completely out of fulfillment, yes, it is parama prema, it is bhakti, over, there is nothing further to be done. But rashtra bhakti is very very close to the supreme bhakti that the scriptures speak of. So I will take the example of that throughout my lectures, because it is very very easy for everybody to understand that. Mother love example is not relatable for everybody, but patriotism is relatable for everyone. There is no exception. So I will always take that example and try to extrapolate it. It is very easy to extrapolate patriotism into devotion. It is very difficult, if you ask me personally, it is very difficult to extrapolate mother's love into devotion. I can't do it. I cannot convince you that mothers, I cannot extrapolate that and make it devotion. There is still lot of difference, because your love is for one particular child, it is not for everyone. Whereas when it is nation, you are looking at it in a very broad way, to the entire nation, including everybody in it. So patriotism is one very lofty emotion, very sattvic emotion that we always, not always, sometimes feel. So if you can increase that type of emotion, that is sattvic emotion. There are varieties of emotion which come in all will come into one category. If you feel intense reverence for something, that is also sattvic. If you feel intense compassion for something, that is also sattvic. But again, compassion is another word people have misunderstood mostly. Compassion, they think that you should feel disturbed. Compassion doesn't make you feel disturbed. Even if it makes you feel disturbed, it is negligible in front of what disturbance you feel through rajas and tamas. Compassion does not make you feel empty or disturbed. If it makes you disturbed, it is not compassion. So in sattva, even if you say there is disturbance, it is like very small disturbance and after that extreme productivity. In tamas and rajas, extreme disturbance, some productivity here and there. Productivity is there, you can't say no. When you feel stressful, when you feel agitated, when you feel afraid, something you will do, you cannot say no, but it will be highly inefficient. The disturbance quotient will be very high, agitation quotient will be very high, the activity quotient, the expression quotient will be very less. Whereas in sattva, when you move towards sattva, the disturbance quotient will reduce drastically. It will still be there, you cannot negate it completely. It will be there, even Buddha accepted it. Even when people argued with Buddha about the same thing which I am discussing, when they argued with him, he said, yes, even in Maitri and Karuna, even there is disturbance, but compared to the disturbance you are undergoing now, it is nothing. It is negligible. A very small disturbance will produce something very huge out of you. So compassion means disturbance quotient is less and fulfillment quotient is more. That overwhelming, overflowing quotient is more. So you are supposed to move towards, in Bhakti Yoga, in the path of Bhakti Yoga, you are supposed to move towards, move from tamasic, rajasic way of feeling intense towards sattvic way of feeling intense. This classification is necessary, otherwise you will go on arguing your whole life, I am happy and happiness is the goal of life. You will stop at that simplistic argument. You won't see in what way I am feeling happy, in what way am I feeling intense. That also matters. You cannot feel happy in a very dumb way. The usual example I give, I could have already given it probably in your Bhagavad Gita classes. Just because a mosquito bite and you eat the mosquito bite, you scratch yourself and you feel happy, that doesn't mean mosquito gave you happiness. You cannot run after mosquitoes to bite you more. It is not a sustainable way to feel get happiness. So if you simply stay at a very superficial level of this argument, you will remain dumb. It will look logical, but it will be very dumb logic. So you have to go a little further and see in what way it is happening also, and try to increase sattvic way of intensity. So Bhakti Yoga, the process of Bhakti Yoga means, now all this is not part of Bhakti Sutras, this is a prelude to that, it's a preface I am giving you, because here it is often talked of, here Guruji speaks of it. So I am giving you a preface to Bhakti, because only if you know the progression, if you know the progress, only then Bhakti will make sense to you. If you directly start speaking of Bhakti, you will simply blink. Bhakti means losing yourself in the love of the God. If I start like that, it won't make sense to you. For some it may. If you have already reached that state, it may make sense to you. But for most it won't. Yes or no? So you have to see preface also, that is there in your material, in some way it has been given to some extent. So tamas, rajas and sattva. And you are supposed to, if you are coming to the path of Bhakti Yoga, you are supposed to increase sattvic way of feeling intense. Now there is one small thing there. This question you might have already got, you asked me that day. This does not mean that you have to give up all rajasic qualities. If it is required, you are supposed to use them as a tool. You are not supposed to get caught up in them. You can still use anger as a tool. For example, in the classes, you will see, I'll give my own example. In the classes, you will see me sometimes talking with a grim face, because sometimes it is required. If somebody is behaving in a disciplined way, we have to display anger. You have to use anger as a tool sometimes. It can be used, but what the meaning, what is the message being conveyed is, you should not get compulsive with that. Compulsive means it has become automatic. It is not in your control. Compulsive means something like, I already explained, your child knows exactly how to make you angry, and if it presses something, he presses a switch and you get angry. It becomes compulsive. If you do it, you can become angry consciously also. That is possible. But this is not told, because the moment this is told, whenever you are angry, you will use this argument. You will say, I am consciously angry. I'm angry, but I'm consciously angry. It is very easy to fool yourself also. You may be highly compulsive and you may say, no, I'm conscious. Lust is another example. You may be compulsively lustful, you may say, no, consciously I'm lustful. No, it's not possible. So differentiation is very thin. Only you can differentiate that within you. So if you are sure that yes, it is being used as a tool, then yes, you use it, fine, no problem.